please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
It's going to be the resolution plan for the two of the second and third largest steel assets under the insolvency proceedings. The total debt is over 1 lakh crore rupees that are set to be evaluated. CNBC TV18's Ritu Singh reported over the weekend that after Bhushan Steel, Tata Steel has also pipped JSW Steel to emerge as the highest bidder for Bhushan Power and Steel. Ritu Singh is here with the news break that she got over the weekend.
It's a big week for bankers as resolution plans for assets worth over 1 lakh crore rupees are set to be discussed this week, and firm bids have been placed. We understand for both Bhushan Steel and Bhushan Power, and Tata Steel has emerged as the front runner, outbidding its rival JSW Steel for both of these assets, where I said the debt is over 1 lakh crore rupees. For Bhushan Steel, Tata Steel has offered a comprehensive package of over 40,000 crore rupees, which includes 35,200 crore rupees to financial creditors as upfront payment, another 1,200 crores to operational creditors, and 12% equity to the bankers in Bhushan Steel. JSW, on the other hand, had offered 28,000 crore rupees and no equity to bankers. With this offer of Tata Steel, banks will take a roughly 27% haircut in this case. As far as Bhushan Power is concerned, again, JSW Steel offered 17,000 crores of upfront payment and another 7,500 crores as equity infusion for Bhushan Power. JSW Steel, on the other hand, had offered only 11,000 crore rupees as cash payment to lenders and 2,000 crore rupees of equity infusion in the company. Now, the COC will meet on the 21st of February to evaluate this particular offer by Tata Steel, and banks are hopeful that they will be able to close both of these deals before the end of this financial year.
Okay, well done, Ritu, for getting both these stories bang on. Of course, the big story really of the day it's going to be. But what about the impact on the companies? We have, of course, three listed companies that will be impacted: Tata Steel, JSW Steel, which has missed out, and of course, Bhushan Steel. Nigel?
Well, Anuj, you know, the best, it's going to be positive definitely for banks. You know, so that there is no question about it, as Lata said. For Tata Steel, well, the sheet was working with a bid of around 25,000 crores, 28,000 crores. That was fine. But JSW Steel, they were aggressive. They came in at 29,000 crores. But Tata Steel, even more aggressive at around 35,000 crores. So in the near term, Tata Steel could be under some pressure. Why? Because they bid very, very aggressively. Going ahead, definitely it's a very, very good, good buy for them because it's a good asset. I spoke to the management as well. They're talking about 8 to 10,000 rupees on an EBITDA per ton basis. Tata Steel has some iron ore as well. That's captive. That could add another couple of thousand rupees. So going ahead, it'll be good for Tata Steel going ahead. But in the near term, a little too aggressive, maybe some red on Tata Steel. For Bhushan Steel as well, you know, we were working with an EV of around 35,000 crores, expecting the debt to be taken over of around 25,000 crores. That gave you a good amount of headroom for equity. Now, you know, now with this, with us talking about an EV of around 35,000 crores, a debt of around 35,000 crores as well, getting transferred, it's giving little less scope in terms of that equity expansion. Going ahead, definitely for Bhushan Steel shareholders, it'll be good because at a later date there could be some merger with Tata Steel. You get a better promoter as well coming in there. But in the near term, maybe in fact, you know, as the chart has been suggesting, the stock has been under some pressure. Maybe the equity value, as Lata has been telling us this morning, that it could be less.
Okay. Yeah. And for JSW Steel, would the state say that, you know, it's a bit of a disappointment, or as Sajan Jindal said, that, you know, okay, they were aggressive, but maybe the other party was.
You know, Anuj, that's a good point, because the street, they had taken it for sure JSW yes. Steel is going to get Bhushan Steel 110%. Mm-hmm. But just looking at the aggression, you know, it's going to be a situation where you say that, okay, they have not got the asset, but just take a look at the valuation. It's quite steep over there. Otherwise, the street would have taken it very badly if, in fact, you know, maybe Tata Steel picked it up for 26, 27,000 crores. But JSW Steel, they put in a good bit at 29,000 crores, and
no,
then they have not got it.
There may be a relief in JSW Steel in that case, isn't it? That they are not getting indebted.
We'll have to weigh both the two situations.
Exactly. You know, because for JSW Steel, which is JSW is the most aggressive player right now, you know, and the big bet was that this is a good asset. Let's not forget that.
It's
perhaps as good an asset as any in the steel industry, the Bhushan Steel asset. So that way, you know, the bet was that if JSW Steel does get Bhushan Steel, that makes it, you know, the biggest, by far the biggest player. And, you know, that way, I don't know. I mean, I would want to see the script.
Yeah, I want to see the script on both Tata Steel and JSW. Because is it that you've won a great asset, but at too big a price.
Yeah.
So is the market going to be disappointed to some extent? Mm. Or you lost a great asset, but then you didn't pay a great price.
Yes.
So will that be the way in which the street will look at JSW?
And also geographically, you know, what the street was working with, JSW Steel will move from here towards northeast, towards the east, and Tata Steel, well, they'll start going for SR Steel. Now, suddenly, all this has put everything, you know, in a bit of a flutter. Yeah, because now you're talking about Tata Steel getting Bhushan Steel. Remember, Tata Steel does 14,000 rupees on a per ton basis. Okay. Bhushan Steel does around 9,000 rupees on a per ton basis. But going ahead, Tata Steel has it in them to upscale that 9,000 rupees on a per ton basis. So we'll watch out all the steel stocks. Absolutely. What a busy day.
Okay, yeah, I just want to make a point here. I mean, just this is on the lighter part.
Yes.
And don't take me seriously. 2008, you know, early 2000s, when Tata Steel was bidding for big companies, Federer and Nadal were locked for number one and number two. 2018 feels like that again. So, you know,
deja vu.
Deja vu, yes.
Okay, but one thing for sure we know is that it will be positive for banks.
Yes, that's true. Just a word more on Bhushan Steel. This morning, our news break is that clearly the equity value is going to be written down. So that is something that will have to be priced into.
But the won't you get, I mean, Tata Steel shares at some point.
Yes, but you'll have to wait. See, the positive there is that banks have been allotted 12% of the shares. Mm. So, you know, somebody is taking a positive bet that at some distant date, there will be an upside. But it's not going to be tomorrow. Immediately, there will be a writing down, is what the bankers tell us. But yes, after 5 years, probably it will be merged. After 3 years, we don't know. For the moment, writing down is
My only limited submission is it's got a market cap of 1,000 crores now, right? And you're talking about 35,000 crores. So is there a case of, you know, saying that, okay, let's put 1,000 crores of equity also in this deal or thereabout?
Apparently not.
Okay.
So the writing down of some of the equity is what the banker confirmed, but he had not seen the bids, and therefore he's did not give me any more details on that. For the banks, of course, it's going to be positive because, you know, 35,000 crore out of 56,000 crore in Bhushan Steel and 17,000 crore out of 35,000 crore. So they've got 50% in Bhushan Steel and Power and about 65-70% in Bhushan Steel. So the expectation is that the haircut is not 50%, but probably, you know, 35% in all steel plants put together. It's therefore going to be positive for all the corporate lenders today.
Okay, that's interesting. But interesting aviation data, and we've seen some of the stocks do well, of course, say Indigo, for example, and how's the data looking now?
It's looking very good for this month, for the month of January, that is. It's an 11-month high. So the total growth has come in, the passenger traffic growth has come in at almost 20%. This is much higher than the average we've seen. We'll pull up a graph for you. The average over the last 4-5 months has been about 16-17%, but this month it's been 20% in the month. So that's the month of January is actually 20%. That graph has gone wrong a bit. But anyway, nevertheless, the passenger load factors have improved quite a bit because of the tourist season. And SpiceJet has recorded the highest load factors this time at 95%. You know, Jet Airways is one stock that has doubled in the last 12 months. It's seen a bit of a cool off in the last few days. So I expect these stocks to move into the green today. But let's do one thing. Let's move to the FMCG space now. Interestingly, Colgate, we all know, Colgate as a toothpaste maker, but now they've decided to enter into the non-oral category. Mangalam joins us now to tell us more. Mangalam, what is Colgate's foray going to look like in the non-oral category?
That is anyone's guess, Sonia. But the interesting part, you rightly pointed out, we know Colgate as an oral care company. Colgate means toothpaste and toothbrushes. But now, as per a conversation that the CFO of the company had with Deutsche Bank, they've written a note and they believe that the company is looking to go ahead and enter a new non-oral care category in FY19. In fact, as early as the first half of FY19 itself. That is very interesting, and I'd like to see how the street reacts to that. My guess is would be a little negative. Why? Because over the last many quarters, Colgate has been losing a lot of market share in its core toothpaste business to first Patanjali, then Dabur, and all the other competitors are ramping up the natural space as well. Colgate lost some share in both the premium as well as the mass product. So that is something I'll be watching out for. The management indicated GST troubles are still not yet over. they are confident about the company gaining its market share going forward. But remember, the trend will come up for you. From 56%, it's fallen down to 54% itself. So at a time where the company is losing market share, looking for growth in the business by entering the non-core category, I'm not too sure how the investors will react to that.
Okay, thank you very much for that. We don't know whether to call it red or green, but Mangalam is a little worried about the development. Well, Ekta, you have pharma news on both Fortis and on Natco.
Well, yes, I'll start with Fortis and Religare, where Fortis came out with a disclosure over the weekend saying that SEBI is probing into its books and has with regards to the recent developments that we've seen for Fortis. And there are reports indicating that the Serious Frauds Investigation Office is also looking into the books of Fortis as well as Religare. So those stocks would be in focus on account of that. And separately, there's positive news which has come in for Natco, where their API plant got inspected by the US FDA last week and it got zero observations. This was a disclosure made by the company onto the exchanges. And there is additional news from the US that they are gaining market share in Tamiflu generic, which is basically the flu drug, vis-a-vis the likes of Cadila. So currently, Natco has around 77% market share in the US for Tamiflu.
Okay, Ekta, thanks a lot for that. Some other stocks in news, let's go across to Anisha for that.
Well, I'll start, Anuj, with the much-needed progress that we have seen in the much-delayed and much-needed Mumbai Airport project, where Prime Minister Narendra Modi laid the foundation stone for the project over the weekend. Now, my guess is that it will elicit a response in the likes of JCorp and RIIL, which hold land parcels in that area, and the valuation of those parcels is expected to go up. And a direct beneficiary can be GVK, because remember, in October last year, GVK was selected as a developer of this mammoth 16,000 crore project. The Maharashtra Chief Minister reiterated the timeline that the first phase of development will be over by December 2019. So see that as a positive. Other than that, keep an eye out on KPR Mills as well. There is a board meet expected to happen on 22nd Feb, where the company and the board will decide on the considered proposal regarding a buyback. Remember, the promoters hold around 74.9% stake. So weigh the details on that one as well. Back to you.
Okay, Anisha, thanks a lot for that. That 21-year-old dream of the Navi Mumbai project will finally come true. The foundation has been laid by the Prime Minister.
Yeah, but then the loan is with GVK. I don't know how many banks will give the loan. I mean, I'm still really worried whether we have heard the last of the problems of the Navi Mumbai airport.